Thank you. Thank you. So good to be in God's house today with God's people. Y'all are lit up in this place today. It is awesome. Well, it's great to be able to worship the Lord and also get into his word. And we're going to do just that. But before we get into his word today, I'm just reminded every time that I get an opportunity to share God's word with his people is that people didn't come to hear you. They came to hear a word from God. And so I want to go to the Lord and ask him to be with us as we prepare this word today. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your goodness, and thank you that you are the real thing and that we don't have to sacrifice for imitation. We can come to you boldly at the throne of grace. But I pray that you would forgive me, God, of any sin that's in my life in this hour to be able to share your word. The people of God have gathered all across this city for a word from you. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would do just that. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I don't know about you, but this has been a rather challenging week, not only to minister, but frankly, just to be alive. It was about this time last week, we were getting out of service, and I was spending some time with our elders and going over some things, thinking about our church, and one of the elders said a helicopter had gone into the side of a mountain in California, and nine people had passed away. And as the day went on, we learned more and more about that. In fact, as the week went on, there almost wasn't a conversation that you could have or go on social media and not see the reality of what was happening, the fact that Kobe Bryant, a basketball player, and much more than that, a father, had passed away, and his daughter and seven others. We pause and we ask for God's grace and mercy on the families that lost their lives in that tragic accident. But we also were reminded of another situation that happened. Another situation that was tragic that didn't get as much press and as much news. Reverend Lawan Adandi from Nigeria, a pastor, was kidnapped on January 3rd, and video shows him being pushed into a car as he was kidnapped by Islamic extremists for his faith. And they made him give a ransom video that was given out a couple weeks ago. And in the ransom video, he was told that he was to ask for a discreet sum of money, but he also was to renounce his faith in Jesus Christ. And I want to read to you what he said before I go into the text, before I go into the Word of God. I want to read to you what he said. I'm not discouraged because all conditions that one finds himself is in the hand of God. By the grace of God, I will be together with my wife and my children and all of my colleagues, he said. If the opportunity has not been granted, maybe it is the will of God. Last Monday, he was beheaded by his captives. He's now in the presence of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He didn't die aimlessly. He died standing for something. And the question today, as we get into the text, is what are you willing to die for, Harvest? What are you willing to die for? And so we are in the book of Mark. I want to invite you to open your Bibles if you don't have one. One has been provided for you nearby. But open your Bibles to Mark chapter 6. We're going to be in the 14th through the 29th verse as we are returning to our Just Jesus All Authority series. And just by way of announcement to those that are here, we are going through the book of Mark, and we'll be in the book of Mark for the better part of the first half of this year. And the Lord has put on my heart a word for our church that I believe will be a blessing to you personally as well as the church. And the title of the sermon today is this: Lessons for the Journey from a Fool. Lessons for the Journey from a fool. You might ask, what can we learn from a fool? And thank you, I'm glad you asked. There's four things in particular that I believe that Mark has for us in this text of ways that we can learn from a fool. And as we think about this text, we probably should do just a little bit of background of the few verses that are before the text that I'm reading. Jesus Christ has sent out the disciples two by two for the first time. He has transferred his authority and given it to them, and they are going out to minister. And by all indications, it was a rather successful trip. The missionary journey, we're told, was very simple. They went out and proclaimed that people should repent, and they casted out many demons. And the Bible says that they anointed many with oil, and the sick were healed and delivered. That's what precedes this passage. But this passage that I have the privilege and honor to share, it doesn't have a whole lot of joy. It's really hard for me to even deliver it because I'm a person that I love to preach joy and victory in Jesus Christ and be triumphant. And outside of Jesus, the favorite character that I have in the Bible is Barnabas. So to get to this passage, I was rather messed up. And I had to ask the question, why did Mark actually put this passage in the scriptures? It's in the gospel, so it must be important for us. And I think there's two things in particular that Mark wanted to summarize for us, and it brings us to the truth right up front that I want to share with you today, that Jesus never promised that following him would be easy, but he did promise that it would be worth it. Jesus never promised that following him would be easy, but he did promise that it would be worth it. And it was interesting that this passage comes on the heels of what I just shared, the miracles that happened, and right before the 5,000 are being ministered to that Pastor Dave is going to share next week. And it's to remind us that the environment that we minister in is dangerous. That the reality of ministering and sharing the gospel is not something that is to be taken lightly for those that call themselves Christ followers. And so with that, if you would, go with me to the word as I read beginning in the 14th verse. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some said John the Baptist has been raised from the dead, and that is why these miraculous powers are at work in him. But others said he is Elijah, and others said that he's a prophet like the one of prophets of old. But when Herod heard it, he said, John whom I have beheaded has been raised. Wow. For Herod, it was him who had seized and sent John and bound him in prison for the sake of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because he had married her. Just pause. Can we all just together say mess? That's a hot mess. We're gonna come back to that in a little bit. For John had been saying to Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to put him to death. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he kept him safe. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he heard him gladly. The scriptures continue like this. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his nobles and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. For when Herodias' daughter came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it to you. And he vowed to her, whatever you ask me, I will give you up to half of my kingdom. And she went out and she said to her mother, for what should I ask? And she said, the head of John the Baptist. And she came in and immediately with haste said to the king, I want to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. And the king was exceedingly sorry, but because of his oaths and his guests, he did not want to break his word to her. And immediately the king sent an executioner with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison. and brought his head on a platter and gave it to the girl. And the girl gave it to her mother. When the disciples heard of it, they came and took his body and laid it on a tomb. Wow. That's the cheery message that I have to give to you today from the Word of God. Well, the first lesson that I see in this text that I want to share with you is when seeking to learn about Jesus, I should rely on wise men or women who know him, not the curiosity of fools. When seeking to learn about Jesus, I should rely on wise men or wise women who know him, not the curiosity of fools. You may say, Ed, that's rather harsh that you would use the word fool. Why did you use that word? Well, thank you. I'm glad you asked. The Bible is very clear about what a fool is. The definition of a fool, according to the Bible, is someone who's unwise, someone who lacks sense, someone who lacks judgment. And fools don't want to learn the truth. They often laugh and turn their ways and their eyes away from the truth. It's a continual pattern that we see in this text. But because I don't want you to just take my word for it, let me read two scriptures to you out of the Word of God. Proverbs chapter 18, verses 2 and 3. Proverbs chapter 18, verses 2 and 3. Listen to what the Word of God says about fools. A fool takes no pleasure in understanding, but only in expressing his opinion. When wickedness comes, contempt comes also, and with dishonor comes disgrace. But the Bible continues in Proverbs chapter 10, verses 23 through 25. Listen to what the Word of God says about fools. Doing wrong is like a joke to a fool, but wisdom is pleasure to a man of understanding. What the wicked dreads will come upon him, but the desire of the righteous will be granted. In verse 25, when the tempest passes, the wicked is no more, but the righteous is established forever. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever known a fool in your life? Just keep looking this way, smiling. Don't look at the next to you. It might not be a good day. Just keep looking this way. Look at me. Do you know a fool? Have you ever met a person who is a fool? I would suggest to you that a fool is not someone that should be followed. And the Bible starts in chapter 6, verse 14, with introducing us to a man named King Herod. King Herod was a very wicked man. He actually was the one of seven sons of Herod the Great. And to condense the time and give you a little bit of history, there were five of the boys who actually had King Herod. Herod was their surname, and this was Herod Antipas. And so this Herod was a very wicked man. His family and the entire family was incestuous. There was absolute mayhem and sin all throughout this family. And this man had surrounded himself with friends who were unwise. And the Bible lets us know in verses 14, 15, and 16 that they were wondering, how would Jesus Christ have these powers that I just talked about? How would Jesus Christ go about doing these things? And the answers started to come rapidly and quickly. Maybe it was because he's John the Baptist who's raised from the dead. Or maybe he's just another prophet. Or my favorite is this. Herod actually thought that Jesus was John the Baptist who he beheaded. Oh, for me to be linked with Jesus Christ as so close that someone would think that I actually am Jesus Christ in the flesh. It's a humbling thing that John the Baptist would never say about himself, but it shows the reputation that he had, but it also shows the lack of clarity that was in that day about who, in fact, Jesus was. And so here we see these ungodly men who are talking to a fool who is the king. And by the way, he's not really a king. Mark was being very gracious. The Bible lets us know as we do more research and look outside of scripture that he was actually a tetrarch, which was also one fourth or a person who was over one fourth of his father's kingdom. So Caesar Augustus did not even trust him with his own father's kingdom, only gave him one fourth of the kingdom. It wasn't even his. And so here we see in the Bible a man who really doesn't know who he is, who's thirsting for power and authority, and he's curious about who Jesus is. And it really reminds me of the second lesson that came to me in the text. As we get to verses 17 and 20 through 20, the second lesson is this: when I'm faithful in my convictions about Jesus, my conscience will lead me to be faithful toward Jesus. When I'm faithful in my convictions about Jesus, my conscience will lead me to be faithful toward Jesus. This is where the story turns and becomes a bit confusing. So I need you to lean in and see in verse 17. It says, it was Herod who had sent and seized John and bound him in prison for the sake of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because he had married her. I told you this was a mess, so let me just unpack it a little bit. Herod's half-brother was named Philip. Philip was already married to Herodias. Herod was so full of lust in his own life that he divorced his own wife and put her away. She was of royalty. In fact, her father was an Arabian king. So Herod decided, I'm going to divorce her. And the Arabian king became quite upset. In fact, he was so upset, they went to war. And Herod, this Herod, Antipas, he actually lost the war. Many of God's people said the reason why that happened is because he went against the law. But the law of Leviticus chapter 18, verse 21, and also chapter 20 says that you cannot look on the nakedness of your brother's wife. That is a sin. And so he had married her in sin and was trying to keep his sin concealed and separate. I'm curious, have any of us, as we look at Herod and we want to call him out, have any of us tried to conceal our own sin? Yeah, I have. Have any of you ever been in the lust of the flesh and you found out that I was sinning for so long, it became difficult to actually repent because sin had become familiar in my life. And this is what the case was with Herod. He was in love and lust with his brother's sister's wife. And so they end up getting together, divorcing their spouses, in family, having an incestuous relationship with one another. I told you that it was a mess. But what's interesting is you continue to read the text, look at verse 18. For John had been saying to Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to put him to death. Newsflash, y'all might not want to mess with Herodias. Girlfriend had it out for John the Baptist. It was on. You keep talking about what I can't have, and you know what? I'm the king's wife, so I want to let you know, serve you on notice. I'm coming after you. I have a grudge after you. I want to actually see you killed. But the Bible says he could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man. I love that. And he kept him safe. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he heard him gladly. Isn't this interesting that we're listening to a sinful man who took up for John the Baptist? He's like, dude, I know my wife's a little crazy, so what are we gonna do? I'm gonna put you in jail because I'm tired of you talking about our marriage. That's the first thing. I want you to stop talking about that, so I'm gonna put you in jail. But the second reason he put him in jail is because his wife wanted to kill the prophet who he said was holy, and he couldn't find anything wrong from it, and he was perplexed and curious when he spoke. I believe a lot of people come to church for a lot of different reasons, and maybe you're here today and you're far from Christ, or maybe you're here today and you know Jesus Christ and you're walking in sin. I want to give you a caution from the Word of God that Herod shows us. You can actually like Jesus and not follow Jesus. You can like the songs and the coffee and the and the nice seats and the parking lot. You can like all the things about Jesus, but at the end of the day, the question is, are you willing to follow Jesus? Jesus wasn't curious in social media. He didn't want to be liked. He wanted to be loved and followed. The question is, are you willing to follow Jesus? He was willing to listen to what John the Baptist had to say. He was even curious. He was perplexed in his soul. He was conflicted. I love this woman. I know I'm in sin. I'm doing all kind of crazy stuff. But every time this man speaks, I feel like he's talking to me. Anybody ever been there? There's times when I've been in the lobby after preaching and people have come up to me angry. Who told you about my life? I'm sorry, I don't know you. I didn't know anything about your life. God in his conviction, he speaks to us. The gospel is an offense to those that don't believe, but you don't have to be. The gospel is an offense to those that believe, but you don't have to be. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 says that the word of the cross is follow or foolishness translated to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved by it, it is the power of God. There's something that happens when the word of God goes forward to those that don't believe or that those that are in sin. It is already of conflict for them. But we don't have to be as believers. You can be kind. You can be grace-filled. You can be loving in who God has created you to be. But here in the text is where I believe it gets challenging for me. I mean, how could a man be loved and be thrown in jail? I'm sure John the Baptist and his friends were at small group. And I'm sure when the prayer request time started, I'm sure someone raised their hand and said, can we pray for John the Baptist who's in jail? Can we pray that he would be delivered and that he would be able to come home? And I'm sure that people were pleading the blood of Jesus and calling out and asking the Lord to deliver John the Baptist. And it makes me think of a challenge for all of us. Those who are here or online at the sound of my voice who don't know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, or people who walk with Christ, there's something that identifies all of us together. Absolutely all of us will experience. And it's called suffering. We don't like this passage because we don't like to see the hero suffering. He didn't do anything. Why is he thrown in jail? God, why would you do this? I want to ask you three little questions, and they're not small in the gravity, but I want to ask you, what happens when your plans and God's sovereignty collide? What happens when God does something and disappoints you? The fact is, does God have the right to disappoint you and your plans? Or maybe you've asked this question this week. Pastor Ed, why do bad things happen to good people? Why do bad things happen to good people? I love that we can ask these questions honestly to God because God will speak powerfully through his word, and Jesus already has let us know something. Newsflash, everybody who's here will suffer in your life. Everyone who's under the sound of my voice, there's a 100% chance that you will die if the Lord delays his coming. Thank you, Pastor Ed, for all the gracious news that you're delivering today. You will die. Absolutely, all of us will die. But here's a loving thing that Jesus did. In John chapter 16, verse 33, he says something that to the disciples that I want you to grab onto. When Jesus promises something, you should hang on to what he says. And in John 16, 33, Jesus proclaims this. He says, I've said these things to you that in me you may have what? Peace. But it gets even better than that. In this world, it will be gravy and roses. Is that what the text says? In this world, if you're saved and you live in North America, you will have no problems. You will be full of blessing and prosperity. Isn't that what the scripture says? What the scripture says, in this world, you will have what? Tribulations. You will have problems. You will have drama. But here is this, the answer doesn't stop there. He says those few words that I love, take heart. Y'all need to take heart. Y'all need to take a chill pill, sit back. Take heart. Why is that? Because I have overcome the world. I'm greater than anything that you will ever experience in your life. I know that you're suffering right now with that family member who is far from Christ, or the medical report that you received, or the person who left you because they didn't say that they loved you anymore. I know that you are suffering because you're single and unsatisfied and don't know whether or not it's ever going to happen for you. I know that you're suffering, but the bottom line is this: I've overcome the world. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. But it's kind of hard when you're in ministry sometimes, because you suffer in front of people. You can't get in silence by yourself. Sometimes you suffer in front of those that you serve. It's interesting, the only thing that separates us who are Christ followers and that are not Christ followers is this: it's how we go through suffering. And over the last year, it's been interesting to watch a pastor that many of us have been praying with. Some of you know him, Dr. Tony Evans. Dr. Tony Evans and his beautiful wife, Lois, shared with the world that about this time last year, that a medical report came back that was very challenging. A rare form of cancer had come back in Lois, unless the Lord decided to do something different, would probably lose her life in 2 weeks to a month. And they went online and asked for prayer that God would sustain them in this time, in this season. As he went through the Word of God and preached the Word of God and loved his wife and his family came around them, an interesting thing that happened, God delayed the assignment, and she lived another 8 months. But a few weeks ago, she lost her life. What happens when you pray and God doesn't do what you wanted him to do? What happens when you ask God for something and you don't know how you're going to go through? What do you do in moments like that? Well, I want to show you 1 minute from her funeral where her son preached the sermon. He eulogized his own mother. And it reminded me 10 years ago when I had to do the same thing for my own mother, who was 59, who died of a heart attack 10 minutes before I was to minister the word of God. I want you to look at the screens as you think about your suffering. Go through it like this.
And as I was wrestling with God, he answered.
Yes. Beautiful.
And he said, number one, you don't understand the nature of my victory. Because I didn't answer your prayer your way doesn't mean that I haven't already answered your prayer anyway. Because victory was already given to your mom. You don't understand. Because of the victory that I have given you, there was always only two answers to your prayers. Either she was going to be healed or she was going to be healed. Either she was going to live or she was going to live. Either she was going to be with family or she was going to be with family. Either she was going to be well taken care of or she was going to be well taken care of. Victory belongs to me.
Somebody needs to be reminded today that victory belongs to God. Your victory belongs to God. See, the reality is we don't know what God is doing. We don't know what he is allowing when we experience hardship and we experience suffering. But the text takes us back as we go to the third lesson that I learned. As this flashback begins where Mark takes us back to the moment when John loses his life. Here's the third lesson. When sin is allowed to reign in my life, it takes over every area of my life. When sin is allowed to reign in my life, it takes over every area of my life. So here we are, King Herod, verse 21. The opportunity came at his birthday party. He decided we're gonna get a little turned up. So we're gonna invite the nobles and we're gonna invite the dignitaries of the day. We're gonna invite the military leaders. And ladies, newsflash, this was not a ladies' occasion. This was a men's only occasion. Debauchery, drinking, just absolutely out of control. And at this time, as he's celebrating his birthday, his wife notices this is the opportunity. This is the opportunity where we're going to strike. And she sends their daughter, her own daughter, his half-daughter, who the Bible lets us know as we do research that she was probably between the ages of 12 and 15. He sends his own daughter comes in. She sends him in, and here's what happens. As she's dancing, his lusts overcome him. How grotesque that a man doesn't have a spine to stand up and put covering over his daughter and take her out. This will not happen in my house. This is our house. This is my daughter. We will not defile God's presence with my daughter dancing in this way. But he didn't do that. He watched his own daughter and became overcome with lust and looked at her and said, whatever you want, I'll give it to you, up to half of my kingdom. What would cause a mother to send her daughter in and just say, dance for some strange men? What would cause a man to be so full of his sin that he could not make a wise decision and be able to cover his daughter? It's because when sin overcomes us in our life, it reigns in every area of our life. This is a birthday party, and this is what ends up happening. Just as a caution, I want to just say this to you. Choose your friends wisely. Choose your friends wisely. Everybody that likes you and says that you're awesome doesn't love you. Everybody is not on your side. The fact is that you are in a battle where Satan wants to destroy your life. And nobody at the party, not one dignitary, the Bible says, stood up and said, we shouldn't do this. We need to cut this out. We need to stop. Everybody participated. Everybody was full of sin, and everyone was overcome with their lusts. The Bible tells us in verse 25, and the king was exceedingly sorry because the request that came was to take off John the Baptist's head. But because of his oaths and his guests, he did not want to break his word to her. The Bible says that he was exceedingly sorry. That word translated is only found one other time in the Bible, and it's in Mark chapter 14. It's when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and he agonized and he was overcome with grief as he prayed and considered going to the cross. That is the same word that is used here. So we see a man, Herod, overcome with grief, overwhelmed at this request. So he is the king. He still has a chance to make it right. And he decides instead, I care about what people think about my reputation and who I am. And so the Bible says that he sent an executioner to do the deed. Before I finish the text, it brings us to the fourth lesson that I feel that we learned today. It's this. When my heart is turned away from the invitation to follow Jesus, it is impossible for me to make wise decisions for Jesus. When my heart is turned away from the invitation to follow Jesus, it is impossible for me to make wise decisions for Jesus. He immediately sends the executioner to cut off Herod's head. I can only imagine John the Baptist when he saw the executioner coming forward. I mean, after all, this is the man that Jesus said was greater than any prophet who's ever lived. The man who was his cousin, who when they were babies in Luke chapter 23, when Elizabeth came to see Mary, John the Baptist leapt, it says, in her womb. He was so excited when he heard about the name of Jesus. This is the same man that in chapter 1, when we started the series, had baptized Jesus Christ. And now, the king is acting in haste. In his lust, in his pride, he immediately acts rationally to have his head removed. There's three takeaways from this amazing passage that I feel that we need today. And the first one is this, is unlike Herod, John the Baptist knew his mission in life. Herod had no idea who he was. He was thirsting for power all of his life. He never knew who he was, and he never was resolute in his conscience, and he was never a person who could make sound decisions. But in the contrast, John the Baptist knew who he was. The brother had a terrible fashion sense. His diet was awful, locusts and honey. He didn't have any dates. Never aspired to get married. He knew, I have two things that I'm doing. I'm repenting and giving the message and telling people that we need to repent. And the second thing that he did is he knew he was calling people to greater obedience in God. The question today is, do you know what your purpose is, Harvest? Do you know why that you work at the bank? Do you know why that you're a teacher or a custodian? Do you know why you're an attorney? Do you know why that God has given you the gifts that he's given you? What is your purpose? And how are you using your purposes to extend God's purposes in the world? But the second thing is this. John didn't set out with a goal to be different from everybody else. He just wanted to be obedient to the call. He wasn't trying to be different for different sake. He just was trying to be obedient to the call of Jesus Christ on his life. Because it reminds me of our truth, which is the third takeaway. As if you don't remember anything else today, I want you to remember that Jesus never promised that following him would be easy. But he did promise that it would be worth it. I wonder today, as I close this message, Herod never figured out the real reason to live. This is the same Herod that in Luke chapter 23, we find that he went in front of Jesus. And he still was curious as Jesus was headed to the cross. He said, Jesus, why don't you just perform some miracles? I mean, you're the king. I'm fascinated. I've always wanted to meet you. Always curious, never convinced, never convicted of his sin. But for John the Baptist, he had nothing left to fear. As he was walking with that executioner, I wonder what it was that was going through his mind. I wonder if he was thinking about baptizing our Lord and Savior, or was he asking the question that maybe some of you are asking when you go through suffering, is it really worth it? Is it worth it to go through all of this? Is it worth it to have the pain and the agony that I experience? Is it worth it? And I can imagine in that moment that John the Baptist was on his knees. And as the executioner had that axe, it started to come clear. I've actually done what I was asked to do. I'm the forerunner of Jesus, and there's nothing left to fear. God's got this, and it's time for me to go home. It's time for me to go home and be with the Father. And as that axe was coming toward his neck to sever his tendons and bones and to take him out, he could say, Jesus never promised that this would be easy, but it promised that it would be worth it. Harvest, what are you willing to die for? Let's pray. Father, your word penetrates us and challenges us. And as we think of John the Baptist, we thank you, Lord, for his testimony that while he was silent in this entire passage, he modeled what it would look like in a few years of what it would be to follow in the same footsteps you did, to stand before the Father and stand in the gap for us. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would help us to stand as good soldiers, that victory belongs to you, that we don't have to fear because you are our shelter. We don't have to fear because you've already conquered the world. We don't have to fear because you are our Lord and Savior. Do it, God, for your glory. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.